This lecture is all going to be about oxygen transfer rates and the oxygen uptake rate by the cells. So what you will see what the rate limiting factor is for OTR and also how the general formula to calculate this. So I'm not going to give an example of the calculation in this particular lecture, but that will be the next step. And you will see that you need the power number calculations for this. And then you should also know what methods you have to improve OTR in your bioreactors. Now, if you remember from the previous lecture, is that the oxygen solubility, so of the gas in the liquid, was quite low. So the problem was, in order to improve the oxygen transfer, so you'd have your sparger on the bottom, and even though you would sparge in a lot of oxygen, it would be consumed within seconds by the microorganisms. So it's very important that you need to improve the solubility for all of this. And if you think about like how the reaction would go, so you would have the stage where your cells are, when they slowly start to grow, so that would be plenty of oxygen. The cells are growing, 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 and then you will see there will be a stage where you have a stationary phase where OTR and OUR are in balance. And at one point you're going to see cell death, which could be because there's not enough sufficient nutrients. It might be because you don't have enough oxygen. It could also be that your cells start mutating after a certain amount of time. And then you will see it will gradually go down. So then in the initial stage is more about how fast your cells grow. Then there will be a plateau where you will see the oxygen uptake rate is limited by oxygen. And then you will see that cell death occurs. Now, the oxygen uptake rate, it does vary. So you remember there are also cells that don't necessarily need oxygen. And it is a critical design parameter. So what you will need to do is you will need to look at the cells, and based on what culture you're working with, you would design your reactor accordingly. Think about the oxygen uptake rate within the reactor. So you would have your little gas bubble, it goes from the interface, it goes into the liquid, then it needs to be transported within the liquid as the interface, and then it will need to go in the cell. So as you can see that gradually, you can see that it does go down, and you see at the interface there's like a bigger drop compared to what you see at the interface. So what does that mean? So if we're looking at the bulk of the liquid, in general, that's not what's the limiting factor here. So only if we're working with liquids that have a very high viscosity, so for instance when we're working with suntan gums, the bulk of the liquid is not what's limiting the oxygen transfer. What you will see, and look at the two-phase transitions there, you will see the biggest drop is from the gas to the liquid. So you say the biggest drop is there because of the limited solubility of oxygen in the liquid. So you should be aware that the gas-liquid interface is the critical step, or that's the rate-limiting step on oxygen transfer. So here I'm going to talk about how we actually get to the equation for the oxygen transfer rate. And the first thing you have to understand is that it's not possible to measure interfacial concentrations of oxygen. So if we want to look at the mass balance, we need to consider the overall mass transfer coefficient. And the flux of oxygen is normally equal to Na is, so big K, so overall mass transfer coefficient times the driving force. So that's the concentration gradient of oxygen. So Cl star is related to the concentration of liquid phase oxygen in equilibrium with the bulk gas phase. And if this one is not provided, you can also look at the solubility. So if you have 100% saturation, and your maximum concentration of oxygen that's available within the reactor is actually the maximum solubility at a certain temperature or at a certain pressure. Now, how do we determine the overall mass transfer coefficient? So in that case, we have to take into account both the resistance at the liquid side, but also the one at the gas side. And remember, H was related to Henry's coefficient. And if you remember that oxygen was only slightly soluble in liquid. So what you get then is your Henry's coefficient tends to be really large, which means the Kg is much larger than Kl. And what you get if you consider the formula from the previous slide, you would see that if you look at the overall mass transfer coefficient, that all the resistance actually lies in the liquid side. Yeah? So what we substitute, instead of big Kl, we substitute by Kla. And what you then get is that the oxygen transfer rate is equal to Kla times the driving force, which is the concentration gradient. And this is a very important formula when it comes to bioreactors. And we're going to practice in the next lecture how you can actually calculate these values.
So now we know how this works. So we know the formula for the oxygen transfer rate. We should also know how we can improve it. So obviously we can improve by increasing the Kla. or we can make the concentration gradient bigger. Now, first looking at the concentration gradient, we can do that in two different ways. So what we could do is we could increase the pressure, but when you do that, there's like a maximum to what you can do here. So if you make the pressure too high, so yes, when you increase the pressure, you do get more oxygen, but you also increase the pressure of carbon dioxide. So carbon dioxide has an influence on the pH, and that tends to be negative for cellular metabolism. So you have to be careful with how you increase the pressure. And the other way you can do this, and this is not very common practice in bioreactors, because it's probably the main reason for it. They say it's because of health and safety reasons, because it can be explosive, but it tends to be kind of like a pricey way of doing it, so it's quite expensive. So what you could also do instead of putting in air, you can also enrich it with oxygen, so going towards more pure oxygen, so there's relatively more oxygen available. Now the other two ways of how you can do this, and you will also kind of see there are some drawbacks associated with this, is by then increasing KLA. And KLA you can improve by either putting in more air or by increasing agitation. And both of them have some drawbacks. So if you think about improving the mixing, remember that these cells can be sensitive to shear. So if you overdo that, you might damage the cells in the process. And likewise, if you increase the rate input, you put oxygen in. So imagine you have your reactor, oxygen goes way too fast. So if it's not distributed appropriately, you can get the concept of flooding. So you have enough oxygen in principle, but your mixing is not sufficient. So the cells don't actually get the oxygen which they need in order to grow. It's just a diagram for yourself in order to familiarize yourself with how all of these concepts are linked, so you can get roughly an idea of what it looks like. There are lots of things that can have an impact on KLA. So if you remember, for instance, when we were looking at anti-foaming agents, this can have a negative impact on KLA. But there's also just the impact of having particles within the reactor. And the influence of particles is not very clear, because it can go both ways. And that's why I'm kind of going to explain that in a little bit more detail. So what you would see is that if you have particles there, so the more of the microorganisms you have, the lower KLA is going to be in general. Now, if you have those particles in general, the first thing you can have is that your KLA reduces because your viscosity is altered. This is probably less likely. But then these particles do have like a big influence in the surface area. So when the particles are a bit smaller, you might actually increase your surface area. So you would have relatively more area into which the bubbles can go to. However, it can also be that large particles actually disrupt the bubbles, and thereby they reduce the area. So you're never quite sure what's going to happen. In that case, the only thing you can do is determine KLA experimentally. What should you have learned from this lecture? So the gas-liquid interface is actually a rate-limiting step in oxygen transfer. You should know the general formula for oxygen transfer, and we'll come back to that later. So in the next lecture, what we're going to do when I show you how you can calculate KLA, you should also be able to work out oxygen transfer in bioreactors. And once you know the oxygen transfer, the important thing is that you can make a prediction of how many of the microorganisms you can actually have in your reactor and what it is that they need to grow. And then we've also shown different ways of how we can influence oxygen transfer. But for these, you should also know what some of the drawbacks are. So when we're going to look at the scale-up, you need to be able to consider how can I improve oxygen transfer, but how can I combat some of the drawbacks that are associated with improving your KLA.